Welcome to our 72nd episode of Two Tankers and a Cat. We're your host. I'm Charlie.
And this is Russell.
Our key points today is we're going to talk about the real first tank. I guess it would be Leonardo da Vinci's, you know, tank that he designed back in the 1400s, which is going to be cool. And the second thing, we keep getting messages about this North Korean M2020 tank, or as we have officially named it, the meme tank.
Kitty.
Ladies and gentlemen, my cat, Ala. Well, I can't say her name.
Oh, you just did.
Well, I didn't get it all the way out. So, anyway, well, it is a show about tanks and cats.
Yes, it is.
Okay, Russell, most of our non-American listeners were not aware we were just celebrating a major U.S. holiday called Thanksgiving. Yeah, it's another American holiday where we eat to excess and hang out with people we would never normally hang out with. How was your Thanksgiving, Russ?
Just another average Thanksgiving for a law enforcement officer. I wound up working that day, and I did make something a couple days later. I made some turkey and mashed taters and gravy, and so I did get to eat a little bit.
So why everybody else is sitting down to a big Thanksgiving dinner and hanging out with relatives that we hardly ever see, you're driving around a patrol car.
Yeah, yeah. Brother and believe it or not, we had several calls for service that day, too. So.
Oh, yeah, because you know, Bob's always going to get drunk and start a fight.
Yeah, that's true. That is very true.
All right. I didn't even want to discuss this, but okay, so we have been getting contacted about our lack of discussion about this super new tank revealed during a military parade with the, I think it's the 75th anniversary of the foundation of the Workers' Party in North Korea, you know, that North Korea military parade. And people have been asking about, you know, a past episode stating that there were tanks before World War One, and so you know what, let's just jump in on the World War One stuff before we get into the meme tank. So let's start off with the pre-World War One tank that I was talking about in this prior episode.
All righty. Yeah, the precursor to the modern tank, Leonardo da Vinci's armored car invention, was capable of moving in any direction and was equipped with a large number of weapons. The most famous of Da Vinci's war machines, the armored car, was designed to intimidate and scatter an opposing army. Leonardo drew the plans for the first armored car in 1485. I don't know, Charlie, weren't you around then?
Thanks. Thanks a lot. I'd like to introduce everybody to my best friend, Russell.
Leonardo da Vinci described his idea for an armored car in a job application to the Duke of Milan in 1482. He said, "I can make armored cars safe and unassailable, which will enter the close ranks of the enemy with their artillery, and no company of soldiers is so great that they will not break through them. And behind these, the infantry will be able to follow quite unharmed and without any opposition."
So basically he's saying, I'm going to put this armored car, we're going to go forward, we're going to have the infantry behind it, and they're just going to smash through whatever divisions, blowing them away, you know, basically scatter them with their infantry just being able to, you know, walk in behind. But we got to remember, this is like the 1400s. So there's no motors, there's, you know, no cars or anything like this. This is him just sitting down coming up with this idea.
Da Vinci's vehicle has a number of light cannons arranged on a circular platform with wheels that allow for 360-degree range. The platform is covered by a large protective cover, much like a turtle shell, reinforced with metal plates, which was to be slanted to better deflect enemy fire. There is a sighting turret on top to coordinate the firing of the cannons and the steering of the vehicle.
Da Vinci's saying, okay, we're going to put a commander hatch on it. Where this old boy gets up there and says, hey, they're in front, fire cannons, you know, 6 through 12.
Yeah.
And they're loading and everything in the comfort of the inside of this turtle shell or this tank. And he's even thought about angling to give, you know, this reinforced wood and metal plates, you know, more armor protection. Tell us about the design.
The concept was designed while Leonardo da Vinci was under the patronage of Ludovico Sforza in 1487. Sometimes described as a prototype of modern tanks, Leonardo's armored vehicle represented a conical cover inspired by a turtle shell. The covering was to be made of wood and reinforced with metal plates that add to the thickness. Slanting angles would deflect enemy fire. The machine was powered by two large cranks operated internally by four strong men. The vehicle was equipped with an array of light cannons placed around the perimeter. The gears of the design were located in a reversed order, making the vehicle unworkable. This is thought by some sources to have been a deliberate mistake by Leonardo as a form of security, in case his design was stolen and used irresponsibly. It is almost impossible to fix this problem successfully without taking away power from its forward movement and strength. The vehicle would have been too heavy to move and would have lacked the battlefield mobility seen in modern tanks that make them so effective. The armored vehicle was designed to intimidate the enemy rather than to be used as a serious military weapon. Due to the vehicle's impressive size, it would not be capable of moving on rugged terrain, and the project could hardly be applied and realized in the 15th century. Around 2010, a group of engineers recreated Leonardo's vehicle based on the original design and fixed the mistake in gearing.
So Leonardo always drew most of his inspiration from nature itself. Give us a good example of that.
Yeah, as always, Leonardo took inspiration from nature for his designs. The outer shell of the tank is based on the turtle shell. Leonardo often took inspiration from nature for his inventions. Human subtlety will never devise an invention more beautiful, more simple, or more direct than nature does, because in her inventions, nothing is lacking and nothing is without purpose. It was actually designed to be driven straight onto a battlefield and to decimate the enemy with its 360-degree cannons with this turtle shell design. Nothing even close to Leonardo's design would be seen again until World War I, almost 400 years later. Even though several centuries had passed, Leonardo's design was superior to World War I tanks in a subtle but ingenious way. Sloped armored plate. In Leonardo's time, the closest thing to a tank that could be found on the battlefield were elephants with up to three men mounted on them. Leonardo despised harming or injuring animals in any way, and this may be one of the reasons for his invention of the tank.
You know, even back then, you know, we had animal rights people.
Exactly, yeah.
So he was an animal lover, just like we are.
And, yeah.
But without animal power, there was no gas or anything like that. How was he going to power this thing, Russell?
The tank was to be powered by four men operating hand cranks. This design seemed feasible as the gear ratios would allow the men to easily turn the hand cranks, although this would result in slow speeds, I would imagine pretty slow speeds, across the ground. Several other men inside the tank would fire cannons at the enemy. The cannons were placed in all directions from the tank, and as a result, could fire in 360 degrees.
So this was top secret military stuff back in his day. You know, you kind of hit that he had made some design flaws in there in his thing. I wonder if that had to do anything with that. What kind of security did he have in place to, you know, keep his design secret?
It's actually unknown whether or not Leonardo purposely built flaws into his design for the tank to deter enemies from creating his designs for their own evil intent. There is a very simple mistake whereby two of the main shafts going to the wheels would spin in the wrong direction if the tank was built exactly from the plans, thus rendering each other obsolete. They would work against each other and cancel each other out. It is well known that Leonardo despised war and everything to do with it, so this could be intentional or simply a mistake. It is, however, quite unlikely to be a mistake. Just remember that Leonardo designed the first self-propelled vehicle, the first constantly variable transmission, and the very first ever spring-driven clock. Such a simple mistake by a man with a broad understanding of mechanics is unlikely, to say the least. There are, however, some inherent flaws in the design. The wheels are too thin to support such a heavy vehicle in damp conditions. They would most likely sink into the ground. Leonardo does have studs on the wheel to aid friction, but it is unlikely that they would help either. Modern tanks overcame this issue by adding caterpillar tracks in the early 20th century.
Yeah. I mean, he knew what he was doing.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, okay, this is pretty obvious. I'm going to have the cranks going in opposite directions.
So yeah.
Screw it up, and let's make the tank tires real real small, too small to, you know, it'll just sink into the. He had all that. He just put that in because he didn't want anybody snagging his ideas.
Yeah, exactly.
You'd said that it was even better than some of these World War One tanks because, you know, remember, they didn't have a lot of sloped armor on those. They just, you know, I mean, look at the Mark V. If you look at the side, that's just a big, wide barn that you can shoot. The whole sloped armor thing, the 360 and the commander hatch up there. That is just, Leonardo was a genius.
I know. He actually had the concepts and the plans. It was just too far before the time to actually put it to use, I guess you'd say.
Could you imagine what he would do today?
Oh, man. Incredible. Yeah. Truly incredible. We need to get some engineers on here that actually, we need to get an engineer or two on here and interview them that's actually designed and made tanks or armor in the past.
Oh, I didn't tell you, we got hate mail from one of our French listeners about the Leclerc.
Oh, no. Yeah, I figured that was coming, yeah.
He's like, you totally misrepresented the gasoline tanks that they're using as armor on the side. I'm like, but it was...
They have to be empty, for God's sakes, and be jettisoned before you be in battle.
Right. But, I mean, there is scientific proof, you know, that they can make the fuel non-flammable and, know, and stuff like that. And it does add more protection. I mean, we understand the science, but it's a simple fact.
It's science.
Yeah, it's science, but it's also funny that... Hey, let's strap some gas cans to our rib cage and go out there and start throwing phosphorus grenades. You know, we understand the science.
Yes, I know.
Talking about jokes, I can't believe that we have to actually talk about this. I mean, if I'd only got one or two or three messages, but we've got a bunch of messages saying, "Oh, you know, you're downplaying the North Korean strength and how brave they are." And how wonderful their new M2020 tank is, the meme tank. I guess that brings us to our second point, the North Korean meme tank. Russell, go ahead and give us the information on that.
This unidentified North Korean main battle tank was unveiled during a military parade that commemorated the 75th anniversary of the foundation of the Workers' Party. It has been given an unofficial name as the M2020 tank, or as we like to call it, the meme tank. Visually, the M2020 tank appears to be a mixed design of the American M1 Abrams and the Russian T-14 Armata, although its overall layout is more similar to the latter than the former. The front of the turret's armor is angled similarly to the M1 Abrams. The hull of the tank features armor plates on the sides, with slat armor on the rear sides protecting the engine, just like the T-14. The glacis plate of the M2020 is slightly different from the T-14, and the driver's position is located at the center front of the hull. The tank is equipped with composite armor that is believed to be on par with ones equipped on third-generation main battle tanks, and is possibly modular in design. Parts of the turret appear to have armor up to 10 centimeters thick to defend against top attack munitions. Compared to the Songun 915 tank, the commander sits on the right side of the turret. The change in position may indicate an addition of an autoloader inside the turret. The tank has 7 road wheels, indicating that it is bigger than previous North Korean tanks, which have 6 wheels. These road wheels are protected by rubber plates or skirts. The tank's main gun is derived from the Russian 2A46 125mm gun, which is also used on the Chonma 216 and Songun's 915 tanks. A coaxial machine gun is located left of the main gun, and an AGS-30 grenade launcher is located on the left side of the roof of the turret. The tank also has 2 Bulsay 3 anti-tank missiles on the right side of the turret. The Bulsay 3 missiles are said to be reverse-engineered Soviet-Russian 9M-133 Cornet missiles. However, the diameter of the ATGM launchers appear to be 150mm like the 9M-133, rather than 120mm of the 9K-111, and thus have a higher penetration. As the T-72s received by North Korea are of early modifications, they cannot fire missiles through the gun tube, and thus the reverse-engineered gun used on their tanks cannot do so either. Although gun-launched missiles are constrained by the barrel diameter and have less penetration. The M2020 tank is believed to be powered by a 1,200 horsepower engine used on the Sungun 915 tanks. The estimated mass of the tank is about 55 tons. The tank is noted to be relatively compact in size, which is advantageous for armored fighting vehicles traversing hilly and mountainous terrains. The roof of the turret features panoramic sights and a meteorological mast on the right side and smoke grenade launchers at the rear of the turret protected by slat armor. The commander and gunner have separate sights, which are believed to have thermal imaging devices. If true, then it would improve the tank's hunter-killer and night-fighting capabilities compared to older North Korean tanks. The tank possesses a muzzle reference system to improve its accuracy when firing on the move. Hard-kill active protection systems, or APS, are possibly fitted on the lower part of the turret, two in the front corners and two on each side, each containing three tube launchers. This APS layout is similar to the Russian Afghanit featured on the T-14. The sensors used for the possible active protection systems are located in the front corners of the turret. As with all new North Korean vehicles, it was immediately assumed that the vehicle was fake to arouse astonishment and confuse Western analysts and armies. According to some, this is actually a Sungun Ho modified to fit new tracks and a seventh wheel in the running gear, but with a dummy superstructure. As a counter-reaction to the South Koreans actually unveiling the K2 Black Panther.
So I have to go on record. I have friends in the intelligent community. Clear back when we were all cadets in the police academy, like 25 years ago, before they got where they are now. So I cannot release any information of what they told me or how they know, but I can quote from an interview with Professor Sung Woo, the head of Department of Military Drones at Shinhan University and a former policy advisor for the Joint Chiefs of Staff of South Korea. He stated that the M2020 tank, that the tank's development may have been assisted by Iran by using designs from the Zulfiqar 3 tank. North Korea and Iran are known to cooperate with regards to their militaries. So we've done episodes on the K2 Panther, you know, and we've done the Iranian tank here, and we even did the T-14 Armada, right?
Yeah.
When I went to Russell or Minnesota, in there, I've talked about this before, in the movie Courage Under Fire with Denzel Washington, they had gotten some old Centurion tanks and they welded on the skirts and made the, you know, with movie magic to make it look like an M1 Abrams. So if you watch that movie, you will see that it appears that Denzel's, you know, in Iraq during Desert Shield and Storm fighting tanks with his M1 Abrams. In reality, underneath all that fake plating is just a Centurion tank. So it's a fake. So our official Two Tanker and a Cat opinion is it's fake. It's just a weird paper mache version of the Iranian tank with stick-on graphics from like the T-14. It's completely made up. It's actually, I think, what I've been told, it's the one of these Pokpung Ho tanks with an added seventh wheel. It's just a mock-up. There were only 9 of these, and we promise you, you will never see these things patrolling the border or mass production. Russ, I think we've got some pictures. You can look at it. You can almost see underneath that it's not this new super tank. It's a joke. It's the same thing as when you see their infantry marching in these parades with these paper mache guns with like the model rockets under them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You can get on YouTube these, or yeah, watch all their military parades, and you can tell half the stuff's probably fake, in my opinion, anyway.
Yeah, it actually had like a model rocket underneath of it. And if it worked, the backfire would just burn the person up. And maybe they don't care, maybe.
One-time shooter.
Yeah. But when you see them, you can obviously tell that they're papier-mâché and they're done poorly. It's like those horribly done Potemkin missile fakes where the intelligence agency, these are intelligence agents saying, I can't speak to the skills of the North Korean weapon engineers, but looking at these fake missiles, they're paper mache experts are off the chain. You know, these are obviously fake missiles, you know, bodied over wood frames. So these are, this is a fake tank. They put on a seventh wheel. They got some drawings from their Iranian friends, and they added on, you know, meteorological, you know, mass and everything. But they made nine of these. And if you look at the tank, it looks like they just put on cardboard and spray painted Desert Storm colors. It's terrible. I mean, anybody with a little bit of experience about tanks can tell that these are obviously fake. Keep getting these comments. Those weird little keyboard experts talking about how great communism is and are still living in their mother's basements. You know, ask Russ, we still get these silly little butt clowns. You know, the little message, you have triggered me and my entitlement. And as we always say here, you know, at Two Tankers and a Cat, bless your little hearts. And if you don't know what that means down south, well, do your own research. You know, Russ, we've had to deal with a lot of keyboard bullies and punks like that. But for them to go on to sites and publish fake stuff, just another way to troll people or make North Korea, you know, this wonderful place and stuff like that. Yeah, and people are seeing these, you know, these new meme tanks, and they're like, oh, these are fantastic, and it's really going to, you know, when the war does come, North Korea will roll right up. They made nine of these toy tanks, and trust us, we're going to get messages from, you know, people that, you know, are, you know, how do I say this, you know. Look, you guys are totally wrong. I read it on Reddit, and it has a laser destructo beam. I don't know. All I can say is look at the pictures. Look at the starving North Koreans.
Oh, and if there's a dang picture out there or video of them actually firing this thing, I'd love to see it.
No, it can't fire. If you look at the gun, he's like, well, it could shoot missiles. No, it can't. Never going to be mass production of these things. They're not going to be, you know, South Korean guards will be up in their post and see these things rolling by, you know, on patrol. So if you're a flag waving North Korean fan, you know, well, bless your little heart, you know. Hit the thumbs up button and thank you, I guess.
Charlie, now, you need to calm down a little bit. You know your blood pressure medication's working in high gear right now, so. How about we go into some tanks in the news? Maybe that'll get your blood pressure down a little bit.
You know what? I mean, these Facebook kids and everything, and they go on Reddit, and they're like, well, you guys are wrong.
Yeah, we're going to talk about some tanks in the news. We're going to talk about an article titled, "The Russian Tanks Massing near Ukraine Sport Mods Against Drones and Javelin Missiles."
Where'd you get this from?
This comes from the Forbes.com. It was actually came out on November 29th, 2021, about 7 a.m.
But who wrote this?
Sebastian Roblin.
All right, we'll give him a shout out. We want to make sure that we get kudos to whoever did it.
But pretty much what he's talking about is as the Russian mechanized forces are massing near Ukraine, actually for a possible winter invasion, tank watchers on social media have identified more and more Russian tanks sporting unsubtle field modifications, seemingly aimed at fending off Ukraine's newest weapons, which happen to be the U.S.-supplied Javelin anti-tank guided missiles and the TB2 Bayraktar drones supplied by Turkey. Both pose a deadly threat to the top armor of armored vehicles, where protection is drastically weaker. The portable Javelin missile consists of a dumbbell-like launch unit with an advanced infrared sensor. Once a target is identified, it can launch missiles that arc steeply upwards before plummeting down upon a vehicle's top armor guided by infrared sensors. The latest manned portable Javelin systems have a range of about 2.5 miles and a high probability of a hit. Furthermore, its top attack launch mode will likely knock out just about any tank while minimizing the exposure of the operator, though each missile is pricey at about $80,000 to $100,000 U.S. dollars per shot.
So when I'm looking at this, they basically put like a cage on top of where these Javelin missiles will hit. You know, our Javelin missile is like really advanced. I mean, it will literally hop up and go straight into the top of the turret. With this cage on there, it's going to hit that cage and explode, act like spaced armor. And it's going to stop, you know, the tank from being destroyed. You know what this reminds me of? When they were in World War II, the American Shermans were trying to break through the hedgerow country. And they were like, our tanks can't push through through there. And those guys got the bush teeth things, you know, that looks like teeth. And they weld them to the front. I think these Russians went up and said, hey, this is what this Javelin's going to do.
Yeah.
And this is what these drones are going to do. Stop it. And they're like, well, we can weld a cage up on it.
Yeah, and they've also, besides the Javelin missiles, they've also got the Turkish-built Bayraktar TB2, which is a relatively short-range combat drone capable of carrying up to 4 precision weapons, including the MAM-L anti-tank missile, which can be guided on target using a laser mounted on the drone. In 2020, TB2s, which individually cost about $5 to $10 million each, destroyed hundreds of military vehicles in conflicts in Libya, Syria, and between Armenia and Azerbaijan.
I just want to cut in. These drones were just, they're very, very effective.
Ukraine acquired its first 12 TB2s in 2019, followed by 5 more for the Ukrainian Navy, with a total force of up to 48 planned. A Ukrainian Bayraktar was first used in combat in October of 2021 to attack a Russian separatist 122mm howitzer that had opened fire in eastern Ukraine, destroying it and killing one crew member.
I love the way they say separatist.
Yeah.
You know, they invaded.
Yeah, they did.
It, you know, the UN, NATO, even Al Jazeera or whatever, the newspaper, went in and they saw that some of these captured Russians' military had their, you know, IDs and their, you know, military ID cards and dog tags. So they're not separatists. They wanted that little section.
They did.
And they took it. And to stop a bigger war.
Yeah, that's it. Yep.
They were like, okay, that brings me back to World War II. You know, Chamberlain and England and France and all those guys were like, okay, you want this piece of land, we're gonna give it to you. But if you go any further, you know, of course you realize this means war. So, but go on, Russ. I'm sorry.
Yeah, the Russian military is visibly experimenting with at least 2 new methods to protect against top attacking menaces. The first is to fit an umbrella of slatted armor on top of the tank. Slat armor is intended to disable or misdirect the fuse of the chemical energy heat munitions in an anti-tank missile, causing it to unleash its jet of armor-piercing molten metal at an ineffectual angle and or distance vis-a-vis the tank's turret.
You know, and that's probably one of their higher, you know, grade.
Yeah.
Protection.
Sure it is.
But the other one, the cage on top, works just fine.
Exactly,
too.
Yeah. These modifications, which have been on Russian's workhorse T-72B and T-72B3 tanks, are non-standardized, suggesting experiments implemented in the field to address a possible operational contingency rather than a factory-issued perfected solution.
And I hate to say, when you're out in the field and your guys are saying, hey, they're going to come through the top of the tank.
Yeah.
Well, what can we use? And they're like,
well, anything you can find.
We'll just put kind of like this umbrella on.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, because it hits there and explodes. Yeah, and then
exactly.
What people can't see by the pictures, we need to post.
Yeah, we will post.
There's enough room for them to get in and out of the tank and, you know, and stand up and work the machine guns. They're kind of out of the way. So you've got maybe 4 foot of spaced armor before it even gets to the actual tank.
Yeah.
Going to kind of nullify.
I know.
Most of the big hits.
I know. Slat or cage armor is commonly fitted to the vulnerable side or rear armor of a tank to protect against ground ambushes, but the new umbrella configuration seems aimed at mitigating attacks from above. However, both the Javelin and MAM-L incorporate 2-stage tandem warheads designed to defeat spaced and reactive armor, and unlike anti-tank munitions like the ubiquitous RPG-7, their fuses are situated toward the rear rather than the tip of the missile. Furthermore, according to munitions expert Neil Gibson, The molten jet projected by a Javelin's warhead is likely long enough and a tank's top armor thin enough that the cage armor would provide insufficient protection even if it triggers the main warhead from 0.5 to 1.5 meters away. In fact, such shape charges may even increase in penetration when detonated at a slight standoff from the target. This also applies to the MAM-L missile, which has a 33% wider 160mm warhead. So pretty much what this guy's saying is it's probably not going to be real effective.
But
hey, it's worth a try.
The guys in the field are saying, you got to give us something. If munition works perfect and it hits in the right spot, and it hits this cage, it may increase and get it through.
Yeah.
But if not, going to survive.
Exactly. Continuing in the article, it says, to be fair, slats combined with bricks of explosive reactive armor might still warp and redirect the primary warhead's blast cone, potentially turning a knockout hit into a less catastrophic one. More promising, slatted armor could provide decent protection against kamikaze drones or grenades and small bombs dropped by a little quadcopter drone, a method of attack used by both sides in the front lines of eastern Ukraine. Some of the flimsier-looking canopies might also be intended to mount camouflage covers or to protect exposed tank commanders from overhead shrapnel.
Most people, especially here in the United States, don't realize, yes, the Russians took the Crimea Peninsula or whatever. They're still fighting. The lines have stabilized, but they still have snipers and, like you said, howitzers and mortar attacks. You can go onto YouTube and just pop up, their news and video. They'll show you combat video of stuff that happened just this week.
Yeah.
Where they firing missiles and RPGs and everything at them.
While the purpose and effectiveness of these new tank modifications is debatable, other likely more important factors could mitigate the impact of the Javelin and TB2 against a major Russian incursion. That's important to consider when prominent foreign policy thinkers like Francis Fukuyama argue these technologies might check a Russian invasion.
Now, we've talked about this in depth, but what we think is going to happen. And my point is this. If the Russians invade the Ukraine during the winter, I do not think the United States will send the military in for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
But will we start shipping more missiles and stuff like we did in World War II? We'll start saying, oh, Lend-Lease, here you go.
Yeah, exactly.
Free stuff. But what I'm saying is I don't think that the other countries surrounding the Ukraine and other NATO members and stuff are going to stay quiet. I think this could turn into something really, really bad. I know, people are like, oh, NATO never done nothing. They're talking tough.
Yeah, they really are. They really are.
They're talking about the new German prime minister or whatever wouldn't authorize anything like that. I don't know. I hope everything gets worked out and everything gets, just peaceful and everybody has a nice winter and there's no death or destruction. But if I was Putin, people are saying, well, he just put the 90,000 up there to scare everybody and get what he wants. Now it's from 90,000 to 100,000. He's bringing up tanks, rocket launchers.
And if I recall, I'm pretty sure he did the same thing the last time he... Like we talked about eastern Ukraine.
He's already invaded that Crimea.
Yeah.
And he has troops there. They're firing every day. I mean, you can't go strolling out there and go take pictures of the beautiful sunset because you're going to get sniped. So, and the Ukrainians, they're buying these drones and these javelins and they're like, hey, we're going to fight. I just don't know, Russ.
I don't either. It'll be interesting.
Anything that happens is going to start with a severe airstrike, a mass
of
airplanes and stuff like that. I don't know. I don't know. If Ukraine's screaming for help and they start moving in, 100,000 troops and tanks and everything, and they're getting real close to everybody else's borders. I don't know if NATO won't jump in on that and help.
I know. I don't know. I've got my opinions, but I hate to voice them right now. But
it's just a, you know, if anything does happen.
I just don't think the United States will get involved. I just, at this point in time, I don't think they would. And it's going to have to take something more serious, like Putin saying, we're not stopping with the Ukraine. We're going to continue marching right on across Europe.
Belarus, exactly. And we're gonna take
exactly.
Poland, you know,
that's when everybody will be forced to become involved, I think.
Technically, you and I both know what's this. If you were going to do anything with a invasion, you'd want somebody on the American side that maybe...
With a backbone?
Yeah, you know, that's why we have to be so careful.
I know.
You know, we can't say anything.
I know. We still can probably say more than people in some countries can say, but I know.
Right.
Still got to be careful.
Me and Russ both know, and we've talked about this, people are going to be coming back and listening to our episodes
yeah.
and go, hey, these guys knew 6 months ago.
Exactly.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
And we told you what was going to happen.
Yeah, because we've seen it before.
History repeats itself.
It really does.
So, and you know.
It's doing that right now in the United States, unfortunately.
Yep. Bad things are happening over here.
Yeah.
We're just not going to be able to help on this
one. I know.
We'll send stuff.
At least for the next couple of years.
Yep. I mean, we'll send javelins.
Oh, well, sure. Oh, yeah. We'll send everything money-wise and.
MREs yeah. and stuff like that. But actual combat troops, I think France isn't going to put up with it.
Yeah.
People say a lot of negative stuff about the new German prime minister, but they know their history.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do.
All right, Russ, let's get off this subject. You know, we kind of dilly-dallied
and
hee-hawed, but we'll hopefully never have to talk about it again. Maybe he'll just back off and go away. And
yep.
Everything will be happy.
We can hope.
So, do we have any messages? No? I did get one from our good friend Craig Moore. You guys forgot to, on the LeCurt episode, he said, you're going to make some of your French listeners mad. And I'm like, yes, we did. So, I guess we just go straight to our Patreon. Who's our first one?
Yeah, our first patron we want to give a shout out to today is Jake Ozaki.
And Kim and Eric Shear, man, they were
great. I know, they really have been. They've been with us right at a little over a year now.
Oh, that's awesome.
Thank you, guys. That means a lot to us, really does. Want to give a big shout out to Antonio Bernarda and Alejandro Martinez.
Bjorn Ben, can't forget him.
Nope. ODS Thero.
And everybody's best friend, Rick Schmidt.
Ricky.
We love Rick.
What's he been up to?
He's still playing tanks.
All right.
Playing World of Tanks. Not well.
Yeah. Oh, man. There went our support.
Yeah, thanks. Sorry, Rick. We sent out some stuff to World of Tanks to get some sponsorship.
Yeah.
From them.
Yeah. We.
So, you know, before we say goodbye, please swing by our Facebook or our YouTube and give us a thumbs up.
Yes. Please do. Every little bit helps.
Subscribe.
Yes. Man. Yes.
We need more Facebook or YouTube.
YouTube and Facebook. The more we have, the more we can do in the future. Guaranteed.
And to all our listeners, we authorize you to get our name out there.
Exactly.
Feel free to share us and even put us on Reddit and saying, hey, they're making fun of us. Everybody get on there and downvote.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's awesome.
That is. Please downvote. Upvote, yeah. Downvote, sidevote.
Yep. In fact, subscribe so you can complain every episode.
Yes, yes. Also, well, I'm going to put a link on Facebook here pretty quick. Probably a little bit after this episode comes out, and it's going to be to our SpeakPipe link, to where you can use your phone, or if you have a headset and microphone hooked up to your personal computer, leave us a little message. And with that message, if you allow us to, we will include that in our next podcast. Just give us some comments. Say hello. Say anything. I mean, yeah, we'll edit a little bit if you say a whole lot of family stuff that I have to bleep, but yeah.
So, for legal reasons, we will tell you, if you call the number provided, we will use your voice. So,
and it's pretty simple. Either on a cell phone or just follow that link, and you can leave a short clip for us, and we'll get you included in the show.
Yeah. We'll even take you bad mouthing us.
Heck yeah. Yeah.
Saying you guys are complete idiots.
Yeah. We'll take it. We'll take it all.
Just make it kid friendly.
At least you're listening.
Well, I believe that's all we've got today, isn't it?
I believe so.
Well, then I'm going to go ahead and call the episode a great episode. This is Charlie.
And this is Russell. As always, happy tanking and have a great week.